So let me just remind you, those of you who are here. So last time we talked about we developed the formalism for constructing the concept charges. I went through Lagrangian formalism, very general, to construct the concept charges associated to asymptotic gauge transformations, in particular the formal prisms, very generally. So the expression for the charge, so basically the idea was the formalism was picking out an expression for the difference in some conserved charge associated to an asymptotic feeling vector X between two backgrounds parameterized by background G psi and phi delta phi. And we get some expression, which is an integral over the boundary of the space time of some quantity Kx of delta phi. So this quantity was constructed from the Lagrangian of the theories through some very cumbersome procedure. And the charge. So given the background and the perturbation of the background, one has a well-defined procedure to compute this quantity. And then the charge is just obtained by integrating it over the boundary of some space extension. And the charge was conserved due to the relation that we showed, which was that the synthetic current of the variation of phi with respect to the vector and delta phi plus the kc of delta phi was zero. So kc is an asymptotic feeling vector of the background. Then what happens is that this term vanishes, and then dk is zero. And if dk is zero, this means that the difference, so this is time, the difference between charges computed at a later time versus an earlier time, which is the integral of dk over this little band here, okay, over this little band over here, vanishes, and this implies charge constitution. Okay. So this is what we did last time. And what I wanted to do today, so I wanted to do three things. So first, I wanted to show you, so as you might remember, the last time my lecture was a little bit painful, going through a lot of formalism. So I wanted to show you how this relation over here leads to really a one-line derivation of the first law of so all the pain that we went through was not for nothing. We can really do some nice physical things very, very easily. And not only that, but it's also this formalism very nicely spits out a formula, a very natural formula for what's called black hole entropy in generalized theory of gravity. So in, for example, higher derivatives of gravity. And this has some nice implications that I will discuss. Also, I would like to say a few words about the converse to the first law. By the way, maybe I should say, so the first law, it tells you that the surface gravity times the variation in the horizon is the variation of the mass of the black hole. Just to know what I'm talking about. So then I would like to talk a little bit about the converse to the first law, which is basically the statement that, so proving this actually requires use of the Einstein equations. So the converse would be, can we get the Einstein equations out of the first law? So this is a really interesting idea, and I would unfortunately not have time to do it as full justice to discuss what has been done. in understanding that question, but I just wanted to give you a flavor of what the derivation looks like and what the idea is important. And if you want to read more, you know, there's some good reviews, so you can just read about it yourself. And then finally, I will switch to the main topic of the course, which is asymptotic symmetries. And I will start by the simplest case, which are asymptotic symmetries of ABX3, three-dimensional Lefebvre spacetime. And this is really, you know, the holy grail of infinite-dimensional asymptotic symmetry groups. So in order to discuss it, we need some basic properties of two-dimensional CFTs, which are the dual field theories to ABX3. And then I will show you a very basic but important holography check. For understanding black hole entropy. And so it will be made incredibly simple by this sort of consideration, but it's actually incredibly important because pretty much all the black holes whose entropy we understand microscopically, I will explain to you what that means, fall into this class. So they have some ABX3 in the near horizon region, which implies that what I will talk about, the arguments that will be given apply to that. So it's only like 2 years ago that the people could account for the microscopic entropy of some different type of black hole. So this is an important piece of what okay, so this is more or less what I'll talk about. So let me start with the first thing, which is the derivation of the first law. The one-line derivation of the first law from this one. So the setup is the following. So one considers some stationary black hole space time. And it is assumed that the horizon of this black hole is a filling horizon. For some filling vector C. So what this means is that xi mu, so first of all, it's a filling vector, so it satisfies the filling equation of spacetime. And moreover, it's perpendicular to the horizon. Okay? So in particular, we have that xi squared equal to 0 on the horizon. And it will turn out that, okay, and we want to define also, okay, so the fact that it's normal to the horizon implies that it will satisfy the following equation. For this k, it has to be a constant and it's called the surface gravity. And we need one more property of this black hole spacetime, which is that so it turns out that if k is non-zero, so this is called the non-degenerate filling horizon. In that case, it has to be of hypotype type. Okay. Just means that there exists some surface, which I'm going to call Curly beam, where c vanishes. Okay. So pretty much, so all the horizons, all the non-degenerate horizons, so non-extremal black holes, pretty much all the horizons that we know of are of this type. Just to give you one example, just to see that the killing vector really vanishes at the bifurcation point. One can take, for example, a red dot horizon. So remember, so regular coordinates are just a different set of coordinates of flat space, of three-dimensional flat space. And they only cover, so if this is T and X in two-dimensional Minkowski space, the Ringler horizon only cover this part of the space I'm over here. These are the orbits of the Killing vector dt. And when you write dt in terms of x and t, well, it's just a booster generator. So you get something like x dt times t dx. So you see that the Killing vector vanishes at this point of view, because x equals t equals 0. So this is the bifurcation. It will be useful at some point to use sort of this property that's okay, so now I can do the this is the setup, so now one one does. So what does the first law look like? Tell me what the first law. The first law says that if I now take my black hole, which is a stationary black hole, and throw some stuff into it, so I make a perturbation d phi, which is on shell. Then the change in the area of the horizon obeys the following equation, k over 2 pi delta a horizon over 4g equals the change in the mass of the black hole plus omega delta a. Okay, and I forgot to say, so I was going to give you an example. So for example, for the Kerr black hole, this Killing vector for which the horizon, the event horizon, is a Killing horizon. So example, the curve, this C is just dt plus some omega horizon d phi. So it's a linear combination of the type translations and the rotations in a Killing. So the statement of the first law, so when I throw something into the black hole, its mass and angular momentum and horizon area vary in a way that satisfies this. So now we want to get our one-end derivation of this equation from. And this is very simple because, okay, so xi is a Killing vector of the black hole background, which basically means that the lead derivative around C of the background field is zero. Okay? So it means that this term is zero. So now we got the dk equal to zero throughout the space, so not just at infinity, but throughout the space. This in particular means that we can evaluate this neutral charge not only at infinity, but on any, say, constant R surface. So we'll be interested in the following cross-section. So we do a cross-section that includes the bifurcation points going all the way to infinity. So on this constant time slice, what the space-time looks like, so we have the bifurcation surface here, and this is R. Okay? Which we've been calling this sigma. So let me call sigma this space. And this is what? Sigma, this sigma. Okay? So I'm just slicing the black hole space like that. And now I want to integrate this equation. So if I integrate dk over sigma, I get zero. But this is equal to the integral of k over the boundary of sigma, which gets a contribution from this surface and a contribution from the horizon, from the bifurcation surface. So what I'm going to get I should make a note that that also Ricardo has noticed that there's no sign checks in most of my patients. But you understand the picture, I guess. So what one gets is integral over delta cube c over the surface at infinity minus integral of delta cube c. Delta over the surface. Okay, good. So now, the integral of the charge difference associated to this Killing vector C at infinity, well, simply gives us the conserved charges associated to C. And since C, say, for a rotating black hole is nothing, what we're going to get from here, so this is really delta pi, here we get delta m plus omega delta pi. Right? Because the mass is the charge associated to tie translations, and the angular momentum is the charge associated to tie rotations. Okay? And minus the integral of B or over the horizon of KC. But remember, okay, from last lecture, remember this K was obtained by delta of some quantity called QC minus C dot delta of delta phi. I don't know if you remember this. So this guy Q was defined through the relation DJ, sorry, J equals DQ, maybe the minus. And theta was defined from the variation of the action. So now what I want to say is that because we're at the bifurcation point where the vector field itself vanishes, it's kind of zero. So what one gets is integral over the horizon of delta Qc. So an exact differential, if you want, in this case. So now you stare at this and you stare at that, so you see that this is a proof of the first law. If we somehow manage to show that this delta QC gives us the variation in the area of the horizon. And that's very easy to do. So for example, for Einstein gravity, one can compute Q from the procedure that I did last time, and one finds 1 over 16 pi g epsilon mu 0 sigma 0 to sigma. Okay, now what happens is that so C itself is 0 on the bifurcation surface, but its derivative is not 0. Its derivative is totally antisymmetric because C is a Killing vector, so its symmetric derivative vanishes. It turns out that this whole thing is actually proportional to the surface gravity times what's called the binormal to the horizon. So to the bifurcation surface. So you see, the bifurcation surface is a codimension 2 surface. So it has 2 normals. And epsilon gives you basically the directions of this tool. So for a simple space line, like for example Schwarzschild, this thing will only be lying in the R2 direction. Okay? So when you do the contraction, so these guys are RT, so these guys will come out to be R theta pi. Okay, and this is in 4 dimensions, in general there will be D minus 2 in this. Okay? So what you get by doing this this integral, you get the delta m plus omega delta j equals to this factor k times some numbers, okay, the 16 pi g and blah blah blah, times delta integral of, well, so I can put the delta out, delta integral of the volume of this bifurcation. Нет, клево тогда. Просто.
I'm confused. Mm-hmm. What is the horizon in your plot? I don't understand.
So this B?
B is the bifurcation point.
Yeah, that's the horizon.
It's the same.
Well, the horizon is an R surface, right? So the horizon is codimension 1, an R surface.
And B codimension 2.
B is codimension 2. You can think of it as the intersection of the future and past horizons, for example, for short. And on this bifurcation surface, the killing vector can change, as you can see in this little example here for the bifurcation point of the reflection. So most horizons are of this type. Yeah, so here this is a cross section, so we're just getting B here, which is this is D minus 2, you know? And sigma is D minus 1. Any other question?
Could you repeat the last, how did you get the right hand side there?
So
you inject the Q somewhere there?
Yeah, so because decay is zero, so I integrate it over this part. So I just get the difference of the integral of k here minus the integral of k here. The integral of k here just gives me the variation of the conserved charges, plugging in that given vector. So somehow the variation of the area of the horizon has to be related to the integration of the variation of delta Q on the horizon. So now for Einstein gravity, one can actually compute what this Q was, because remember one just constructs the usual Noether-Kami function, blah, 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 and just the J is dQ, and you can extract what Q is, and Q is given by this formula, which is basically the Conard formula. And you just plug it in. So then you notice that this C is actually proportional, so this derivative of C is proportional to the binomial to the horizon, which is basically pointing in these arc directions. So when you contract, and this is really mu 1 up to mu d minus 2. So these two indices basically go away, and you're just left with the volume form on the perpendicular d minus 2. Okay, so this is basically giving you the area of B, which is why
I'm not sure that the area of B is the area, what you call the area of the horizon. Is that it?
The area is the area of B.
Okay.
I mean, if you have a stationary black hole, you can do any cut that you want and the area will change. But it's useful for the proof to actually evaluate the area of B, because one can use the vanishing point for this kind of vector.
I'm sorry, can you please repeat that step here? So the first term gives rise to, shouldn't that give rise to delta Q rather than this delta M plus omega delta J?
Sorry?
The first integral there is at infinity. So shouldn't that give rise to delta Q?
Yeah, so delta Q is, so now I have to tell you. So what is Q? So I have to compute Q for that particular vector.
Mm-hmm.
And the mass is defined as the charge associated with dt.
Mm-hmm.
And J is the charge associated with D phi.
Yes.
And I have a linear combination, so I pick the same linear combination, but of the conserved charge.
I see. Okay. So it's delta Q only.
So this is defined in okay. Any other questions? I can also go slow. Okay, so this is the one line proof of the first law for this case. But then remember that this formalism was working for, you know, arbitrary theories of gravity. So I don't need to restrict myself to Einstein gravity. I can take any Lagrangian that depends on the metric, the Riemann tensor, and all sorts of other fields, and then derivatives. Then it is clear that if I plug into this formula the expressions for the conserved charges that I get by computing Q for this Lagrangian, I'm still going to be satisfying an appropriate function. Right? Because basically the integral over K associated with C at infinity will still give me the variation of the mass and the variation of the angular momentum in that theory. So they will have different expressions in terms of the, you know, actual parameters of the black hole solution, but by definition they will be just this. And the horizon contribution is still going to take the form delta Q, delta of something. And that something, well, it is defined such that the first law is satisfied. Okay? So Wald and Iyer provided, so they actually looked at the expression of Q in arbitrary theories of this form, and they provided an expression for it. And the general expression, so they argued that the general expression takes this form. Q is W mu of phi C mu plus X mu mu D mu C mu plus some Y term that depends on phi and the derivative plus an exact term. Okay, so in an arbitrary theory of gravity, you can prove that the D minus 2 form, you know, so this is the D minus 2 form, so this, all of these things are actually forms, takes this sort of form. And it's actually easy to convince yourself you must get something like this, because Q, I mean, in principle, it can depend on C and arbitrary derivatives of C, right? But because C is a Killing vector, it actually satisfies an equation of this sort, d mu, d sigma, c rho, equals r rho, sigma mu mu, c mu. So this is an exercise in Jean-Carol, you can just prove it. So this basically shows that if you have any sort of higher derivatives that act on c in the formula for the charge, you can always trade them for factors of the Riemann tensor, and then get rid of the derivative. So the end expression that you're going to get is something that has a term linear in C, and a term that has one derivative on C. And then there's some other terms that are related to, this Y term and this total derivative term. And moreover, this term that has C has to contain only the anti-symmetrized derivative, because C is a thing. So the non-trivial part of, so this is done by Walt Iyer. So if you want the details, you should just go to the paper. But the non-trivial part of this exercise that they prove is that this term, C mu mu, the expression for it is the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the Riemann tensor into epsilon alpha delta. Okay? So the expression for this x mu nu is obtained, you take your Lagrangian, you derive it with respect to the Riemann tensor as if this were an independent field, and then you dot it into the epsilon tensor like this. And this gives you x mu. And the reason that you only care about x mu nu is that this is actually the only term that's going to contribute to the integral of Q over the bifurcation surface. Well, I guess it's obvious why. So first, C is zero on the bifurcation surface. So we can drop this term. This term is a total derivative. It's exact. We're integrating it over a closed surface, so it drops out. And this term, actually, you need to massage it a little bit. But you compute this variation, and you can show that this variation turns it into a term proportional to C, which is zero on the bifurcation point, and the term that's a total derivative, so you can just drop. So this term also drops out. So in the end, this is the only term that contributes to.
Too much indices, I don't understand mu1, mu d minus 2.
So remember, Q was a d minus 2 point. So it has
minus
indices, so I'm supposed to dot this into dx mu 1.
Sorry, I don't see this.
level.
Okay.
Okay. So, and then you can see very easily that when you take L to be the Einstein Hilbert, so it's just proportional to the Ricci scalar, you're just going to get the bundle of factors for the derivative. So this is why you get the I of them. But in general, you know, given any Lagrangian that might depend on higher derivative terms, this gives you an expression for a quantity whose variation will satisfy you.
Sorry, but you mean that it keeps the same form, or I will have more?
What I mean?
The first law will keep the same form, so or I will have different parameters that will be variated if I take this expression for Q. Or with this form? Or even for this mass?
So what happens is that this guy is always proportional to K into the binomial, right? By the properties of the Killing vector. So you pull K out, and then it will always take the form variation of some quantity Q. And
it was the left hand side, my.
This is always the mass and angular momentum, because by definition, they are the conserved quantities associated to this V and this function.
Ah, okay.
So this will have very different expressions in Einstein gravity versus higher derivative gravity, but because this formalism is supposed to produce always the conserved charge associated to some asymptotic Killing vector, this will always give you the correct definition of mass and angular momentum in that theory. I haven't really specified the asymptotics of this black hole. I mean, it could be asymptotically flat, asymptotically this, asymptotically some other thing.
Yeah,
because this formalism is sort of working in pretty much any space. This will always, by definition, give me the well. It has been checked, of course, but in all cases where it was checked, this gave the correct definition of mass and angular momentum. The first one is if you define L and J this way. But these definitions make sense, and they agree between formalisms when you have other formalisms. Okay. So now let me give you an expression for this quantity. So Wald calls this quantity S. So S is 2 pi integral over the horizon. Let me call it horizon. It's a bifurcation surface. Dn might be R mean about sigma, epsilon minimum, epsilon about sigma. Okay, so I've split this into a part that has to do with the binomial and a part that has to do with the form. And this is called the log. Formula for generalized.
So Monica, for example, if I take generativity, I add Ricci cube.
Yeah.
Would not correct the entropy.
No,
depends on your Riemann.
The entropy, yeah, sorry. If you add the Ricci cube, this is the procedure that you have to follow in order to obtain something that satisfies the formula. The formalism ensures that the formula is satisfied. But you have to come provide a new expression for the entropy. And of course, the expressions for mass and charge and angular momentum have to be appropriate to that. I should say one thing: if you have derivatives of the Riemann tensor that appears, then this formula gets corrected, you have to subtract derivatives of the area, but the full expression is given in one. So, and for Facebook, you can go and just copy. I wanted to say a few words about, I don't know how much people know, so let me just say a few words about this formula. Okay, so as I've already said a few times, this shows that the first law can be made to hold with these definitions in an arbitrary theory of gravity with arbitrary derivatives. It provides a nice expression for generalized black hole entropy. So this expression, and also it has another nice feature is that the entropy ends up being a neutral charge associated to the killing vector that's generating the horizon. So it has some. So this formula is somehow very very nice. It's a neutral charge rather than an entropy. And it's also like made to always give you the correct person. I wanted to say a few words about what it means. Okay, so why do I call it black hole entropy? After all, it's just some geometric quantity that I compute from the metric on the bifurcation surface and its derivative. So why is this called black hole entropy? So the story goes back a long time to Bekenstein in the 70s. So first of all, the black holes are very simple objects. So they're not. If I give you the mass and say the angular momentum of the black hole solution is completely specified. For example, you have the uniqueness theorem for dimensions. They work quite generally for many theories of gravity. Okay. So this would lead you to think that because of this black hole uniqueness, you would think that black holes really, they don't have any entropy. It's just like such standard stuff that I'd be surprised if no one knows about it. Let me just say it. Okay, so the problem is that because black hole solutions are so unique, the problem is that you start running, if you consider throwing various objects into the black hole, you start running into problems with the laws of thermodynamics, as Bekenstein pointed out, because you might take your favorite entropic object, you throw it into the black hole, and the black hole is still specified by the new mass and the new angular momentum. So what happened to the end of the object? And therefore, Bekenstein proposed, in order to not violate the second law, to assign some entropy to the black hole. And because of this nice law of first law of black hole mechanics, it was natural that this entropy be proportional to the area of the horizon, because this looks very much like the first law of thermodynamics. After all, where this quantity S is identified to the entropy, it's proportional to the entropy, and this K plays the role of the temperature. And this became all the more convincing when Hawking showed that actually black holes emit thermal radiation precisely at the temperature proportional to this K. Okay, so that was the motivation. But of course, so this is just a geometric quantity. It was just a conjecture that this would be counting the microscopic degrees of freedom of black hole, which are completely invisible in the space-time picture. So it wasn't until the advent of string theory that it was shown that this quantity, so that the simple area of the horizon divided by quantity, which is the Bekenstein-Hawking energy, actually could be interpreted as a logarithm of some number of microstates of the black holes. And the way that you get this relation is complicated. So what happens is that in string theory you have the black hole. So in some regime of parameters, in some system it looks like a black hole. But then you go to a different regime of parameters, and the same system looks like just some membranes with some excitations on them. And because these are just membranes with excitation on them, you can just count the number of excitations. And omega, take the log of them, and it turns out that this number is precisely equal to the area of the horizon of the black hole in the space-time picture divided by the Maxwell's constant. So, all I wanted to say, in the space-time picture, it's not obvious why this thing should be an entropy, but because we can sometimes have a microscopic picture which looks incredibly different from the space-time picture where these things are just excitations of things, so this is the usual definition of entropy that we call this. And this relation has been checked in many, several examples in string theory. And it was quite important. So this formula that Walden Nyer came up with was really important in matching corrections to black hole entropy. So string theory can reproduce not only this area term, but there are subsequent corrections that scale differently, say, with the charges of the black holes, and you can match them on both sides. So this formula, so this not only check the Wald formula as the correct formula, but it's also a very non-trivial precision test of string theory. So people can compute very, very many corrections and prove that. This is what I wanted to say about thing, because I thought this was very, very standard stuff, so I decided to go kind of fast through it. Are people following, or I expect some people to follow, but
I can't answer.
Was this too fast? How many people thought that this was too fast?
I'm stopping.
You stop. And how many people thought this was trivial?
I vote for too fast.
I see. So most people think it was both too fast and
too fast.
Yeah, sorry. I just thought it was so standard that that people would just recognize it. No, you didn't recognize it.
No, I did, but okay.
Okay, so if there are any questions, I can try to re-explain if people want to ask questions. Sorry?
For Einstein gravity, how do you get from that formula to the...
Oh, this is simple because L for Einstein gravity is R square root of G, right? Mm-hmm. So when you, and this guy is, right, G mu rho, G mu sigma, R mu rho sigma, right? So when you take the derivative of L with respect to the Riemann tensor, you just pick a bunch of factors of the metric. So in the end, you're just going to get some geometric thing which in the end, we'll give you the volume formula.
Can I ask a question? So in the derivation of this black hole mechanics, you assume the stationarity of the black hole, right?
Actually, no. So the original black hole is stationary. The perturbation itself does not have to be stationary if you're regulating things at the black hole.
So if I don't assume the stationarity of the metric or the black hole, do we have kind of black hole mechanics or something like that?
Okay, so the argument that I've presented does not assume that delta phi is stationary. Mm-hmm. The only place where stationarity is assumed is when I pull out, so remember this factor of k, so the charge looks like this. And the surface gravity of the horizon just comes from this anti-commutative derivative C. And this formula, so when k was inside q, this formula is true even without stationarity. If I want to be able to pull k out of the integral, then I have to assume that the n black hole is also stationary with some. But if I let k in, then for arbitrary
on-shell perturbation. Mm-hmm. So, for example, if you have a cosmological constant, the asymptotically facilitate, still.
Where do you compute your charges?
Yeah, that's.
You need a space time with a boundary.
Okay.
But, so that's a tricky case, but mm-hmm. asymptotically flat and the asymptotically sound.
Could you please re-explain the meaning of the y and the z terms that you just flashed and why they vanish?
Yeah, so this is a long derivation in Walt-Eyre, where they prove that the formula for this q that you derive from the Lagrangian using this complicated procedure, it can always be made to take this form. So they just, I mean, it's a lot of massaging of putting derivatives on the other side. It's very long, but in the end, they prove that this is the general form of the expression.
Why do the last two terms vanish? Is it trivial to see why the last two terms vanish?
Yeah, so this is trivial, I guess.
Okay.
And this guy, well, it's, so you have to do, because you're computing delta q, so you do delta y of phi, you derive the c phi. And now, you can, okay, so what's happening? Yeah, because the background is invariant under the action of xi. The only place where you're going to get a non-zero contribution is when the delta acts on phi here, because otherwise you just evaluate to zero. So this is going to be equal to y of phi delta, well, xi delta phi. This is the only non-zero contribution. And then you can just pull, because again, phi is invariant under xi, you can just put the lead derivative upside. And then you use a fancy formula that I gave last time, that this is proportional to xi. This is just an identity. Xi of dy of delta phi plus dc delta y, something like that. So this term doesn't contribute for the same reason as z, and this term is zero because xi vanishes. Something like that. Okay, so any other questions? But was it at least the logic clear? That's the only thing that I wanted to show. That this gives you a very, very general formula, and then the okay, details. Okay. Cool. So now what I wanted to talk about. Delta of C mu, so it's, well, C mu doesn't vary, so it's C mu delta of the Einstein equations into epsilon mu alpha 1 to alpha 2. Okay? So, if you don't assume that the perturbation is on shell, and you integrate this equation, so again you're in a black hole background which has this feeling vector C, so this term still vanishes because of the feeling condition. Then what you get is that the integral of dk over the surface sigma that you have here is no longer zero, but it equals the integral of C mu into the Einstein equation to this epsilon mu over the surface sigma. Okay, so you see that now you have something that looks like a first law, so this is delta m plus omega delta j minus this delta of the quantity that we've been calling the black hole entropy. But there's a term on the left-hand side which is proportional to the Einstein equations, integrated over this space-like surface sigma that goes in between the bifurcation point, bifurcation surface, and so now the interesting question is we've assumed the Einstein equation to prove the first law. Can we use the first law to try to prove Einstein's equation? So that's the converse of the first law. This is a really interesting idea that was first put forth by Jacobson in 1995. And basically, what he said was something like the following. So suppose you have this nice small space-time, but there's some sort of theory of quantum gravity that describes this space-time microscopically. And this microscopic description that you don't necessarily need to know what it is. So for example, in string theory, we have maybe a CFT. We have the CFT that provides the microscopic degrees of freedom. But in principle, you need to know what it is. This microscopic description obviously has to satisfy the first law of thermodynamics, because it's a universal law. So and then he said, assume, in addition, that you have some reason to associate the entropy in this microscopic description to the area of some horizon in the space-time description, and the temperature in the microscopic description to the certain acceleration of associated to this horizon or to the surface ground. Then, okay, the fact that the first law is satisfied should imply, for this sort of equation, that the Einstein equations are and the reason that this argument is really nice, if this argument is true and you can really get the Einstein equations by applying some sort of holographic version of the first law, what this really means is that the Einstein equations are not a very fundamental object in your systems. They're just equations of state for your system. So therefore, if you're wondering whether should we be quantizing Einstein gravity, well, probably the answer is no, because Einstein equations are just an equation. So what I think is really, really beautiful about Jacobson's idea and paper is that it really shows this non-fundamental nature of the Einstein. Okay, so what Jacobson did...
So, question. When you call Einstein equation, you mean including possibly also the higher dimensional terms, have Riemann cube and so on? Those will appear as well on the left-hand side.
Here.
Yes.
These are so the gravitational equations.
So the 14.
So obviously everything has to be done in the full theory, but for arbitrary Lagrangian, you know how to construct the truth solution, you know how to construct the charges, there's a definite algorithm, so you just do it. And it's going to depend on the okay, so now you see from this formula that if you just try to impose the first law for a black hole, what you're going to get is some sort of integral of the Einstein equations over this large region outside the horizon. So you're not really going to get, you're not going to be able to get the Einstein equations at the point. You're going to get the integrated version, which is not very useful. So what Jacobson did instead was to concentrate on local wavelength horizons. So basically, he was looking at, say you pick some space-time point P, and you consider a set of accelerated observers such that P, and you know, the whole transverse space is basically the bifurcation surface to this set of of this sort of horizon associated with the accelerated observer. And he looked at some sort of, then he made some energy pass to the horizon, the area was increasing. Then he imposed the first law, that the area would be proportional to the energy that is sent to the horizon, and he could derive the Bartmann equation. However, there are a couple of drawbacks to his derivation. Which is, the first one is that, you know, even in cases where we have a microscopic understanding of the entropy of a horizon, such for example in string theory, we know that the area of a black hole horizon corresponds to the thermodynamic entropy in the dual field theory, we don't have any such interpretation for the entropy of local horizons. Even in the UCFT, we don't know. So local field in the horizon is just you know what it is microscopically. And secondly, if you're trying to do an arbitrary theory of a higher derivative gravity, his derivation is cumbersome. It's not so what I wanted to discuss was a way in which one can use actually AJCFT to get a precise version of the converse of the first law, so a precise derivation of the linearized Einstein equation from the converse to the first law. Precise derivation. And this is done by concentrating, so you see, so local linear horizons, we don't know what they mean. Whereas black hole horizons, the problem is that we always get integrals of Einstein's equations, which is not useful. So the idea is to basically concentrate on a set of horizons that are in between, which are global, a set of global ring of horizons. For which the advantage is that we do know what their area, what entropy their area corresponds to, and it turns out that their area corresponds to entanglement. And I guess no one can see what I'm writing. Their area corresponds to entanglement. Of what these things are about, because I don't have time to review the whole literature of entanglement entropy and horizons. So let me describe it. So do people know what entanglement is?
I
in parallel. In parallel entropy is a formula. So suppose you have some system and you split it into two parts. And the whole system is in a total state, so I will assume to be a pure state. So in principle, the state of the system could be also specified by a density matrix, but I'll just take it to be a pure state. And okay, I split it like this. And the total Hilbert space of the system is going to be split into two parts. Okay. So now one can define the reduced density matrix. For subsystem A. Now A has a trace of the B part of the Hilbert space at the density matrix of the total system, which is just subset. And then the entanglement entropy is defined as minus trace over A, rho A, rho A. So it's just a full Neumann entropy associated with this reduced density matrix. I mean, in principle, one can play, if you want to understand what these things are, you can play with total states. For example, if you take a two-spin system, you can take A, up down plus B down up, something like that, trace over the second spin and then try to get the density matrix, the reduced density matrix for the first spin from this, and then you see how it depends on A and B. So you see that if A or B are zero, then the state that you get is pure, but for A and B both non-zero, you get the next state. And moreover, you get maximum entanglement entropy when I am. If you want to play with this, I can give you the next exercise. So this S measures the entanglement between the two subsystems. And it actually does satisfy a first law of what's called entanglement dynamics. So one oftentimes write rho A, so one can define an operator HA, which is called the modular Hamiltonian. Yeah, this relation. And then it's easy to show that the variation of the entanglement entropy equals minus trace delta rho A, and log rho A is HA, right? And then there's another term where the delta hits the log, but actually that's zero because trace of rho, and in particular trace of rho equals one, so trace of delta rho is zero. And this is basically the variation of the expectation value of the modular Hamiltonian associated to the state rho A under this perturbation. Okay. So this is called the first law of entanglement. And written like this is not terribly useful, because in order for it to be useful, I need to tell you what the modular Hamiltonian is. And in general, the modular Hamiltonian is just some, for arbitrary rho, it's some horrible monocle operator that you cannot write down, so this is not very useful, except in a few cases. And these few cases are the following. So case that's very well known is when your system is a constant here, in article constant here, you don't see variant. You take the total state of the system to be the Minkowski vacuum. And you take the region A to be the half-life. Then, so let me take in some direction x1, so this is x1, this is time, all the other directions x2 and so on are perpendicular to the board, and I take my region A to be the half line here. Then it turns out that HA is the integral of d minus 1 x, x1 into p 0, 0. The stress tensor of the QFT, the time component of the stress tensor. And this formula should not at all surprise you because, what is this? This formula is very much related to the fact that you all know that if you consider a Rindler observer in Minkowski space, so a Rindler observer is an observer that only has access to this part of the space, so he or she only has access to the half-life, this is a thermal density matrix. The density matrix is precisely equal to this HA, which is basically the Hamiltonian that's associated to the Euclidean rotation that takes you around like this. Okay, so I don't have time to go into the derivation, but basically the way that you do it is, this is just the derivation of the Rindler Hamiltonian. So you go to Euclidean space, you compute your density matrix by imposing boundary conditions, on the lower part and upper part of the line, and do the path integral over everything else. And then you see that it's natural to use coordinates which go like this. And you find that the density matrix is a rho to the generator of the Euclidean rotations around this point. Have I said something that people know? Or
so this statement is true for all quantum field theories?
This is true for all Lorentz invariant.
Sorry, is the system B the remaining part of the space?
The system B? Yeah. So, okay, very good. So this isn't a fixed time slice. Okay. So the full system is space. So I cut space in half. This is A, and this is B. As you might be familiar from calculations of Hawking radiation and so on. I don't know if people did this. Okay, then okay. You might remember that the way that you derive the fact that a Rindler observer sees a thermal density matrix is by doing precisely this. So a Rindler observer is really an observer that only lives in system A because he only has access to half of the space. And the thermal density matrix that he sees is nothing but the reduced density matrix obtained by tracing over this half of the system of the full density matrix for the Minkowski vacuum. And the way that you obtain this in a path integral language is the usual derivation of this thermality observed by the Rindler observers. Is really by computing the path integral with different boundary conditions here and here over the rest of the plane. And then it's natural to slice this like this. And the you know, going in between the different slices is really generated by this rotation generator in Euclidean plane, which taken back to Minkowski is nothing but a boost generator. And of course this thing is nothing but a mu in C mu, where this is just the normal to the constant time slice over which I'm computing my Poisson charge. And this is the boost generator x1 dt minus t1 dx1. So for people, okay, we've been discussing this other formalism, but you know, in the usual, you know, the usual way that you compute conserved charges in, say, a quantum field theory is by integrating the stress tensor of a constant time slice, dotted into the norm of the time slice, and the Killing vector, and this is precisely what this is. And it comes from this path integral derivation in the Euclidean space, which is those generated by operations. Okay. Another case where the modular Hamiltonian is known is for a CFT. Again, taking the total state to be the vacuum. And A is a ball of radius R. So in this case, H, maybe I should call it H ball, is the integral of the ball d d minus 1 x times r squared minus x squared over 2 r into t. So here what you're doing is something incredibly similar to Ringer's. So now you have your CFTs, so this is space. You cut out the ball of radius r, sitting at some point in 0, okay? So this is the ball. And now you try to compute the reduced density matrix of the CFT, so the CFT is an integral space ball, by integrating over the region outside the ball. And what you obtain is a density matrix of this form, where H is this guy. And just like in the Ringer case, this H can be interpreted as the generator of some nice isometry. So in this case, it was the boost symmetry, which is up. In this case, we construct what's known as the causal development of the ball. So this consists of the set of all points such that every past directed curve intersects the ball. So this is just the light curve. And it turns out that you have some conformal symmetries that generate this sort of flow inside the causal development. It turns out that this expression for the modular Hamiltonian for the ball is nothing but this type of expression, but with C mu associated to this particular item. So this is very much in analogy to the Ringer space. In the case of Ringer, the causal development of the half-life is really this part of Minkowski space. And the Killing vector that generates the flow is nothing but it's the same idea, but sort of the derivation is a bit long, which is why I didn't go through. And okay, good. So here we get our two examples of useful modular Hamiltonians. And the last piece of information that we need to know is that there is a holographic proposal for entanglement entropy. Okay, good. So now I need to say two words about holography. So there is this thing known as ABS-CFT. And in ABS-CFT, the CFT, in certain cases, it lives on Minkowski space. So this is R d minus 1 comma 1. It's a d-dimensional CFT. So this has coordinates time and space. Time and space going along. And then this is supposed to be holographically dual, entirely writable in terms of a theory of gravity in a one higher dimensional idea space, which is basically perpendicular to this plane. It goes in a holographic direction called Z. So the metric of ideas looks something like this. Vitamin d squared over Z squared. Okay, so you see, basically, so the does this thing look, this is supposed to be perpendicular to this plane, but maybe my drawing is not fantastic. Imagine this is perpendicular. Okay? And the CFT really looks at Z equal to 0. So you see, at Z equal to 0, the metric blocks up. So this is really an infinite distance away. But okay. And what we're supposed to do, so there's a proposal. So now what you want to do is compute, have a prescription for the internal entropy in the CFT. So in the CFT, you pick some spatial size, so I could say t equal to 0, and you pick some region A in the CFT. Then the proposal is that the, so basically what you do, you integrate over everything else, and you compute the reduced density matrix associated with this region A, you compute internal entropy. And the proposal is that this entanglement entropy of region A is nothing but the area of the bulk surface A tilde that's anchored on A divided by 4 times A. So what you're supposed to do, so now you're in the bulk, which is given by this metric, and you consider a bulk surface of minimal area in this same constant time slice that ends, whose endpoints coincide with the endpoint of the region A. Okay, so I should say, so in the CFT, okay, so in the CFT I have this A, it has a boundary delta A, and one must have that the boundary of the bulk surface A tilde, which is sitting here, is the same as the boundary of A. And hopefully, it's somewhat clear from the picture that this is happening. And okay, so what you do in practice, so you compute the area of surfaces that satisfy this condition, and then you minimize it, and this should tell you the surface that whose area computes the gravity.
I'm sorry, but couldn't it just squeeze 2A and have no area? You could approach it toward A and have coincide with A itself.
So what happens is that actually the area rather than being zero, it's actually infinite.
Ah.
Because the metric blows up in the box. So this is some conformal diagram, of course.
Yeah,
the boundary of A is at infinite distance. So basically, I've done a conformal transformation. What I'm doing there is a metric that differs by this factor of Z squared, so that I could draw it on the board. So basically, there's an infinite volume of space that's right next to the boundary. So actually, this area is infinite. But that's okay, because the entanglement entropy is also infinite. And the reason is that, in a general conformal field theory, there's a lot of entanglement between the excitations that are just inside and just outside the surface. So this is actually divergent, like the area of the boundary of A. And there's a nice UVIR relation in holography that tells you that the UV divergences in the field theory, which is this divergence of the entanglement in this case. So as A goes like the area of delta A. So this is a different area, right? the area of the boundary of a question of the impact of the power in books. And you find this precisely this divergence in the space-time picture, but now it's an infrared divergence, it's an infinite volume divergence. It comes from the fact that the surface goes all the way to infinity. And if you identify, so if you put a cutoff that's equal to epsilon in the space-time, an infrared cutoff, you should be matching this cutoff to the UV cutoff in the future. Okay, so that's the proposal that in a CFT, the entanglement entropy defined as such in a CFT should be computed again by the area of a certain surface, this time that intersects the boundary, divided by photon Hilbert constant. This is exactly the same as the formula for black hole entropy, except that that was the area of the horizon of the black hole. And I should say that if one has higher derivative terms, then this area gets corrected again by all the higher derivative corrections and so on. So it's a very similar one-type formula. Okay, good. So now we're almost ready to prove this converse of the first law, which consists basically in using this completely general. Okay, so that's what we're doing. We have the entanglement entropy on the boundary, and we know that it satisfies the first law. And in certain situations, we even have a useful form for this entanglement Hamiltonian, in terms of the stress test. Moreover, there is this holographic relation that associates the entanglement entropy on the boundary, which is a nice information theoretical quantity you can compute in your CFT, to a geometric quantity in the bulk, which is the area of this particular surface. So we can try to use the first law that we know that this has to hold, plug in this expression for the area into the entropy, and try to derive the actual equation. So what we're doing, so we're considering, as before, we're considering a step 5, which is just vacuum and yes. And a perturbation delta phi of it. And delta phi is really only going to be a metric perturbation h mu. okay, I should probably say this. So in ADS CFT, so the vacuum space time pure ADS that I've written here corresponds to the vacuum of the CFT. And if I make a perturbation in the space time, so I add some h mu, dx mu, dx mu here. This will correspond to slightly changing the state in a CFT. So this will correspond to some CFT state psi, which is vacuum plus delta psi. Some small perturbation of the CFT state. So what did I want to say? Okay, good. So the setup will be the following. So we start with the ADS vacuum. We put on top of it some metric perturbation, which is not assumed to be on shell. So a general metric perturbation. And then we impose, and we also assume that the entanglement entropy for region A, which we'll be taking to be a ball of radius R and at some point x0 in the CFT, is computed by this holographic formula as A of this A. Then the idea is to use the microscopic or first law of entanglement, which as you see is trivial to prove, delta SA equals delta HA, for this H, to try to get the Einstein equation. And the reason that this will come out is because, okay, for people who don't know this CFT, this is probably very hard, but basically what happens is this H contains a stress tensor, and the stress tensor is a CFT operator that's dual to the metric field in the box. So this is how you get the constraint from the metric starting from this. So The proof just uses again a trivial rewriting of our.
I'm sorry. I think Ruta Ganagi proved this formula for ground state only in their paper.
No, but there is a general proof by Lefkowitz and Matasek.
Then so that works for any state in the CFD.
That works. So it's a path integral proof. So it uses the replica trick.
Okay.
So yeah. So I should say this. So this this formula. Okay. A general way to compute entanglement entropies is by going through an intermediate step that involves computing Reni entropies, which are based on rho A to the n. Okay. And then you take the limit n goes to 1, or this over n minus 1, something like that. And that gives you the entanglement entropy. And so this is called the replica trick. You can do the replica trick in holography. So you assume that it can be done quite generally. So all you need is some sort of path integral representation of your system. So you need something that has a time recursive dependence.
Okay.
And then so you get the replica trick in your CFT or whatever quantum criteria you have on the boundary, and you simply assume that this has some nice smooth holographic dual described by Einstein gravity plus some hybrid. You have some nice action that describes the gravity, and then it can be shown that this calculation basically localizes. So what you're going to get is a symmetry that has a bulk geometry that has a dense symmetry under the cyclic permutations of the copies, and then you can prove that actually this calculation localizes on the fixed points of Zn, and this fixed point is nothing but this entangling, this minimal area surface. So that's actually a general holographic proof, just using path integrals of this one.
And that shows that for any state in the CFT, you have this formula.
So it's okay. Something like this. And I think there's even a generalization to time-dependent background. So there's also this is for static situation. There's a more general proposal for holographic entanglement for time-dependent backgrounds. And I think there's even some sort of proof in that case, some generalization of this. Okay. So now what I wanted to do is basically give a one-line argument, just as before, for how you derive the Einstein equation using a formal and setup. I'm a red choke, so So this is the boundary picture of precisely that. Now what happens in the box, so the entanglement entropy is supposed to be captured by the area of the box surface, which has the same boundary endpoints of as my region A. So it's going to be some box surface like this. And actually, I can consider the full causal development of the bulk region, which turns out to be just nicely intersecting with the boundary. Okay. So there's some extension of the boundary vector field xi mu into the bulk that actually turns out to be an isometry of ADS. It involves the conformal generator, so it's non-trivial isometries. That sort of generates a flow into the entire bulk region. Okay. And now the nice thing about this is that this portion of the spacetime can actually be mapped to look. So this is just a portion of vacuum ADS. There's nothing to deep about it. This portion of the spacetime can be written in coordinates such that it looks like a black hole. So this is very much similar to what happens in the Rinder case. I can take Minkowski space, I can write it in coordinates. Okay, maybe this doesn't look very much like a black hole to you, but it does have the Rinder horizon. So it's the same idea, but applied here with a much more non-trivial case. So the claim, and I should say, for people who want more details, this is done. Did I forget? So there's a paper by Myers, Cassini, and some other person, I guess 2012. Okay, I can get the full reference, which does this mapping very, very nicely. They explain everything in detail, how you map this to the black hole. But basically, there is this coordinate where this region inside the pink stuff, and it causes development, look like this. Part of the metric is concerned, I guess no one will argue with me that this looks like a black hole with a horizon at rho equal to L. Whereas this part, what it is actually d minus one dimensional hyperbolic. Because of the sim squared, so this is hyperbolic squared. So this is basically. So this region of the spacetime looks like a black hole spacetime, but the black hole horizon is infinite, and it intersects. Your boundary coordinates. So this will run off to infinity. So you see, but you see it in this picture that actually the horizon of the black hole intersects, which is nothing but the minimal area surface. This is the bifurcation surface of the black hole. The horizon is this full length of the So this looks exactly like a black hole in certain coordinates, except that it's not really a black hole, it's just a Rindler type of horizon. And it turns out that this feeling vector xi mu, which I'm not writing just because it really has a Hilbert formula. This xi mu is an isometry of ADS, and it turns out that this null surface here that goes like this is a Killing horizon for xi. And the bifurcation surface, also this, let me call this big meter. So this is the ball on the boundary, and big meter is the minimal area surface in the bulk. So xi mu generates a Killing horizon for this black hole, and the bifurcation surface is precisely the tilde, which is the minimal surface minimal area surface that enters in for calculation of the time. Okay. So the point is that once we set up the calculation this way, I mean, this looks just like the first law. We're just doing the first law that we have. Except that instead of using the usual, okay, so partially, in terms of this coordinate, so this, in this coordinate, sigma is just pb tau. This is the purpose of this coordinate, to write it like this. But we can also rewrite sigma in terms of the usual ABS coordinates written there, and it has some positive expression. Okay, good. So now we're finally ready to derive the first law for this thing. Remember, so up to signs, which I haven't taken care of, so the integral over the horizon of delta q t, and also it seems I don't have very constant notation, so let me call it qt. Okay, so let me just write down the derivation and then I explain it. C mu is mu alpha minus 4. The first law where I left on the right-hand side. So what I'm considering, so it's just vacuum ADS with a small metric perturbation h mu nu on top of it, which is not assumed to be on shell. And then I'm looking at the first law, whatever came from our equation before. Integrate. Okay, so should I go one step back? So remember we had this dkc was equal to epsilon into the Einstein equation. So this was the equation satisfied by dk when we didn't put the perturbation on shell, and now we integrate this equation over this surface sigma, which is the surface over. So that lies in between the boundary ball B and this bulk surface B. Okay. I have also got it here. This is the boundary ball sitting at x naught of radius r, and this is B. Okay, and this is sigma. So integral over sigma of the Einstein equations is integral of dk. And this integral over dk has two components, one component which comes from the integral of k on b, and one component that comes from integral of k on b delta. Now, b lies at infinity, okay, so b lies here, and so this is b delta. Okay, good. But now, from what I said, so from this coordinate transformation, we know that b delta is nothing but the horizon, the bifurcation surface for this hyperbolic black hole. And okay, this is part of the boundary of the system. So it should be clear that this contribution is nothing but delta S. So this contribution will just give the variation of the area of the tilde of the volume. If we're in Einstein gravity, if we're not in Einstein gravity, then we have to just apply the log formula to get the appropriate expression for the entanglement. And this thing is going to be the conserved charge associated to this particular thing that we see at infinity. Equals the integral of the Einstein equations. But what is this, this concept charge?
What is the infinity in your drawing there?
The infinity?
The sigma infinity. Where is in your drawing?
Yeah, sorry. Sigma infinity. Yeah. So this is the sigma.
It's B. What do you call
it? Yeah, which is B.
Ah, okay.
But I wanted to say that it's the portion of sigma, of the boundary of sigma that lies on the boundary.
I mean, I would say the B tilde is sigma infinity if you would add particles.
No, B tilde is extended to the boundary.
If it compared to the previous picture that you drew, the B is the inside, is the.
So,
it's the bifurcation surface which does not involve, but you take the R to infinity, then you take, that is the boundary of the sigma infinity. So in this picture, if I compare, I would say B is the original bifurcation surface that.
No, B lies on the boundary of the space.
Yes?
So it sits at infinity, and B tilde extends into the boundary.
So, but I mean, is this picture clear if you say T equals zero is the whole plane that you draw on the blackboard? And then you say the time evolves, then this the B evolves to B tilde. Is this like this or not?
No, this is a static picture.
Oh.
So I'm taking a ball on the boundary, and I'm trying to look at the bulk surface that has that ends on the boundary of B at the ADS boundary. And has minimal area. So this surface goes into the bulk. So this is the z direction. So this is a constant time slice, which I've also drawn here. And this is the z direction in the bulk. The
yeah, I see. I confuse the z direction with time direction. Yeah. So then this is clear. I see.
Yeah. So also because you see this cause of development. So this was the zero time slice, and the cause of development is the same time, which is what. I'm sorry, the drawing is not fantastic, but so this is time, and really this is the perpendicular, so the entangling surface, it goes into the box. And then, if you want to have maybe a more clear picture, you can actually map this to something that looks like a black hole. So then everything that you know about the first law of black hole mechanics is also applied. So the only thing that we still need to massage is this expression for the contribution to the charge from the integral over the boundary ball of this delta qc. So I'd like to show you that this is nothing but delta h. And the way that you do that, it's not very obvious in this formalism. But if, for example, you map different formalisms for computing in the concept charges, so this formalism in ABS is the same as the so-called Brown-York formalism or holographic stress tensor formalism, in which the charge associated with some Killing vector is computed as the integral of the space over the induced metric on the boundary of mu into something known as the holographic stress tensor times cu. Which in this case, so if the charge in this formalism equals the charge in this formalism, then you see that what you're picking, so you're computing stuff on the t equal to zero slice, so this is 1, and this is t, and then by taking the specific form that this Killing vector has, in those Poincaré coordinates, what you find is that this expression for the conserved charge precisely equals this expression for the number. So actually, this thing is nothing but delta h of the ball. And okay, but these two, okay, so but okay, delta area by assumption was nothing but delta as entanglement of the ball by the holographic relation, or the holographic representation of entanglement entropy. Okay, so we get delta S minus delta H. But because entanglement entropy has to universally satisfy the first law, that would be right somewhere, I guess, this quantity has to be zero. Right, because this is delta H, so I go, the integral over the horizon gives me delta A, which is delta S, and the integral over the piece at the boundary gives me delta of the charge associated to the scaling vector C on the boundary, which I just argued equals delta H by going between the two points. Okay, so what I get on the right hand side is delta S minus delta H. And this thing is assumed to be zero because entanglement entropy satisfies the first law universally. So this thing has to be zero. But from the space-time picture, we know that it also equals the integral of the linearized Einstein equations for this perturbation, which is not on shell, over this surface sigma that this surface on the time. Okay, so this is still an integral relation, it's not very useful as written. But now the advantage of this picture is that we can look at this argument from arbitrary ball of arbitrary radius and arbitrary center position. So by varying the radius of the ball and just moving it around, we can actually turn this sort of integral equation. The only way that all these integrals can give zero as we move this surface around, and also we vary the radius of the ball, is if the integrand is zero. Okay. And so this proves that in mu, delta E mu, and xi mu, zero, well, this is on this particular surface, so basically what we get is that the zero component of time times component of the action is zero. This is what this constant is giving us. Was the argument clear? Okay, so we've got, we identify these things with CFT quantities. We know the CFT quantities have to satisfy the first law. And then we derive this integral constraint on the Einstein equations. But since we can move the ball around wherever we want and change its size, this has to hold locally. And once it holds locally, so what we end up with is that the time component of the Einstein equation for the perturbation has to vanish everywhere. And now what we can do, we can start boosting this region, the t equal to zero region. So what we get is actually all the Einstein's equations that are parallel, with x parallel to the boundary are zero. And the rest, the z component, we can get them because those are just constraint equations. So once they hold near the boundary, they hold everywhere, and that's the region. So this is one way that you can actually, you know, implement this idea that the Einstein equation is some sort of emergent, you know, relation between some universal CFT quantities in some sort of precise way in the context of ABC.
So if you have a black hole in the bulk, this argument would not imply Einstein equation inside the black hole, no? Because these curves will never enter the black hole?
No, if you have a black hole in the bulk, the problem is that the problem with the black hole is that you only get an integral equation over the outside of the black hole.
Yeah.
And you just get the integral equation. Here, the reason that you can get a local equation out of the integral equation is because you can move around, you can change the size of the ball, so, and it always has to hold. It's because you get a family of such relations for any r and for any center position at zero.
Why can't I take some small balls in black hole?
So here's the black hole. I mean, in this case, the black hole really looks like this. So, but this relation also has to hold for this black hole. So if it has for this black hole, you need the Einstein equation integrated over here, and then you can switch it around. It's also possible. So by intersecting all these regions, you can prove that the Einstein equation has to hold over. If you just have one black hole, you just get the integrated equation, so you cannot prove that it has to hold over. That's the only difference.
No. Yeah. Outside of the black hole, it would still imply the Einstein equation, no?
Just the integral form of
it. But you just
the integrated. You see what you get? So what is the relation? So when you have a black hole, you just get that the variation in entropy minus the variation in the charge, in the mass, equals the integral of Einstein equation of all this region. This region is infinite. So you get the integral of the Einstein equation of an infinite region has to be zero. I mean, could be a bit positive here, a bit negative here, and still not zero. The reason that you get it zero at every point is because you have this two-parameter family. Actually, it's d plus 1 because this is at zero mu. Parameter family of black holes, quote-unquote, that you can intersect. And then the integral equation has to hold for it. No matter how we move them around, so then you have to hold it.
So it is not evident. I mean, you want delta E tt equals 0 on the wall t equals 0 plane.
Right.
And it is not evident that if you play by varying the sides r of b and the center, then you have to, the black hole is on this minimal surface, and it is not clear that the minimal surface will extend far from z equal zero enough to cover all the planes.
So the shape, so in polar coordinates, the shape of the so this is z and this is x, the shape of the minimal surface is the same circle. So it goes all the way to z equal to r.
The minimal one?
Yeah, so if you write it in those coordinates.
If r is big, also the, okay.
If I make the r on the boundary large, it also extends more into the bulk because it just looks, of course this doesn't look like a semicircle, but it is actually a semicircle. So it penetrates all the way to z equal to r, so when I send r to infinity,
okay.
It goes.
I get lost on how you extend the indices of E to mu nu from
you can boost this. So t equal to zero, you can apply a boost.
But it's not arbitrary, right? Because the boost you can choose.
Yeah, so you can apply the same argument, but instead of choosing t equal to zero, you choose some boosted slice like this. So then you get a linear, a different linear combination of the Einstein equations having to be zero. And by playing with the boost, you can show that all the components that you obtain by boost have to be zero.
But what I'm confused is that the vector say you choose is must be a killing vector on the
Bunk
space, right?
Yeah, but it would still be, what the boost does, so if you boost a black hole, it still stays a black hole. Right. If you boost a black hole, it's going to be a black hole going with velocity v in that direction. It's still a black hole. So you still have a horizon, you can still have a diameter. You just have to run. This was probably a little bit fast, but what I wanted to show is that, So there's a very nice connection between entanglement and... Okay, so I should make a remark. This formula that relates entanglement in the topology theory to the area of the space-time surface, it's a very profound relation, because I mean I give you some conformal theory, and you know I can take all possible spatial regions here and compute the entanglement entropy, and you know I get some numbers. And what this relation says is that in the bulk picture I should always be able to compute the correct number by computing the area of this associated bulk surface. So that implies a very, very constrained structure of the entanglement in the conformality theory. If you give me a random set of numbers, I'm not going to be able to produce a smooth spacetime that will be able to reproduce it for any boundary region area, and so on. So this is a very profound relation, and so somehow it shows that in a certain sense that the space-time geometry is built by the entanglement message. You need a very special form of the entanglement, and then it takes this nice geometric form. But it's not totally understood how it works. And, so this is just the geometry of space-time, then we've seen that, okay, if we apply this very simple, you know, structural law of first law of entanglement in the CFT, it gives us Einstein equation, so that should lead us to reflect on what does this Einstein equation really mean, given that it's just a consistency condition for that, given this geometric form of entanglement. I also wanted to say that, so here we've matched the entanglement entropy to the area, and okay, the energy was just more than a Hamiltonian. But there's an even deeper connection between information theoretic quantities, such as entanglement stuff, and geometric quantities, especially this covariant phase space formalism. So how should I say? Here, the only thing that we have derived are the linearized equation about the ABS factor. Okay, so. It's nice as proof of principle, but in general, you want to do something a bit more. And people have actually been able to go to higher order in the perturbation. So you can, for example, turn on a scalar field on top of ABS. A scalar field on top of ABS doesn't contribute to the linearized Einstein equation, it comes out of second order. But people have been expanding this relation that we used, the one with the omega and the k and so on, to second order, and they found that expanded to second order, this symplectic form gives, which is expanded to second order, it gives something known as the canonical energy that matches another natural information theoretic quantity, which is called the Fisher information network. I don't know much about it, but all of this is to say that there seems to be a deep connection between entanglement and the space-time geometry in the Einstein equations, I wanted to give you a flavor about it, so something went through, but if you want to read more about it, there's some nice lecture notes by Martha Lambston, which was one of the people doing a lot of this. Maybe I've even written down. This one's 16.09.0.0.0.6, where he explains, you're not going to find all the hardcore derivations that I also skipped, but he explains very nicely this connection between connectedness of space-time and entanglement and, you know, how you're supposed to reconstruct space-time from entanglement in a CFT. He also talks about the first law and also generalizations to beyond the linear order and so on. So I think it's a nice set of the Okay. So in principle, I could go on, but the problem is that I was going to change subject completely. So maybe we should stop here, and next time I'll go back to the main topic of the course, which are asymptotic symmetries. So I'll talk about asymptotic symmetries.
Thank you. Question?